They were known collectively as the Georgia Mafia, Washington outsiders who played key roles in the Jimmy Carter presidential campaigns and in the White House. Among them, Hamilton Jordan, who was the president's chief of staff and top confidant. He died of cancer in 2008. He left behind a mostly finished memoir. His daughter, Kathleen, has edited and completed the book, A Boy from Georgia, Coming of Age in the Segregated South. She talked to Judy recently.
I have to ask you first, it looks like Hamilton Jordan, Kathleen Jordan, but it's Jordan. Where did that come from?
You know, my dad always said it's the Southern pronunciation of the surname. And if you hear it in old spirituals, you'll hear it pronounced the River Jordan. So I think that it's a kind of a long-standing tradition of the South. At least that's what we were told, and we've taken that forward with us.
I knew your father, Hamilton Jordan, because he worked for Jimmy Carter. I covered Carter as governor of Georgia, then as president of the United States. Your father was a strategist. He was chief of staff. But this book really is about his growing up in South Georgia, growing up in the segregationist South, isn't it?
When political junkies hear that my dad has a new book out, they're excited because they think it may be about the Carter years. And what I say to those people is it may not necessarily be about his political years, but it's about his early indoctrination into politics and kind of learning about politics from the people around him and about the formation of his political skills.
He grew up, as we just said, in the segregationist South, from a family steeped in the Confederacy, had ancestors who fought for the Confederacy. That really was what he was surrounded by as he was growing up, and yet he was raising questions.
There are some moments in the book where he really realizes that he has to make a decision. You know, obviously segregation was something that was passed down from generation to generation. And I think that this book is about him realizing this choice is sitting in my lap. You know, I have the choice to decide whether or not I am going to question this or if I'm going to just go along with what everyone else believes. And I think it's about his journey to deciding to follow the moral truth.
And there are a couple of points where he, in fact, says he felt like he was a moral failure along the way, where he didn't speak up when he saw something happening.
Absolutely. He was in downtown Albany, where he was born, which is a very small town, watching Dr. King march, protesting the segregation of the public facilities in Albany, Georgia. And he sees his maid there, Hattie. He's standing with his dad, and you know, they see Hattie's in this protest, and his dad pulls him away and says, "We need to leave right now. Those people are outside agitators, and they've gotten all riled up, and they should be ashamed of themselves." And my dad, you know, said, "Well, what about Hattie? You know, it was this person who he had a real personal connection with,
right.
And she was protesting, and he'd see this other side of her life." And he says in the book, like you said, he marks that as a moment of moral failure in his life, that he didn't stand up for what he realized was right in that moment.
There were also a lot of funny moments in the book. I mean, when he was 9 years old, he went with his family to Washington, went to the Smithsonian, found his family were the McWhorters, and he found a McWhorter who had won the Congressional Medal of Honor for fighting in the Civil War. When he got back to Georgia, he told his grandfather all about it, but then he said, "By the way, he fought for the Union." He said his grandfather just got up and walked out.
Exactly. There's a lot of humor in that, but there's also, you know, there's an undercurrent there, because his grandfather was so proud of being from the South and was so proud of the Confederacy, and couldn't get behind the idea that his family was fighting against the Confederacy.
Why do you think your father was writing this book? You watched much of the time when he was working on it.
Definitely.
Before he died.
Exactly. Yeah. He'd been working on this book for, I would say, all of his life. It took his whole life to kind of formulate the ideas that he expresses in this book. And I think that he was working on it partially because it's a large part of, it's about who he is and how he became the person that he is. But I think it's also an admission of guilt and a story of how he turned himself around. He was working on it in order to not necessarily absolve himself, but to take agency and ownership of a time in his life when he believed things that he no longer believed as a fully formed adult.
You said your older brother started out working on this, but you wanted to finish it. Why was this important to you?
It was important to me because I have struggled for most of my life with the idea of being from the South and the idea of Southern identity. When I was younger, I used to tell my church basketball team that I was from New York because I didn't want to be associated with a place in the country that I thought was a place that was steeped in racism and violent evangelical ideals and things that in my mind felt very negative. And it took me stepping away and going to college in a different state and then living in New York and Los Angeles to understand that the South is such an important part of who I am, and now it is something that I am very proud of. And to not be proud of it is to not take ownership of it. And there are things that are bad about the South, but there are things that are bad about every place in the country. And so it's for me, I did this to honor my dad and his memory because these stories needed to get into people's hands, and also because I wanted to have a greater sense of ownership of who I am as a Southern woman.
Well, it's a wonderful book and a wonderful set of stories put together by the daughter of a man who was very involved in American politics, doing a lot of reflecting. Kathleen Jordan, thank you very much for talking with us.
Judy, thank you.